Okay, so we are going to continue on tent pitching. I'm going to fix this. Okay, so today I will explain tent pitching and especially the map tent pitching method we developed for hyperbolic systems with my advisor Joachim, everybody knows him, and Jay, who is sitting in the back, we saw him in the beginning. Okay, so map tent pitching, what is it? First of all, we need tents, so we construct a tent pitched mesh. I will explain this in a minute. Then we added a mapping to have an easier structure for the time stepping. And then we discretize on the easy structure, tensor product structure, using a DG method. And finally, you can apply a high-order time stepping on those cylinders and have a pretty well-performing method. So our problem setting is that we have a hyperbolic problem. We have a finite speed of propagation, C bar. And the idea is, if we have speed of propagation, we know if we stay inside this light cone, we are fine. We have all the information we need. And we can create some tents. So if we have two elements and the central vertex sitting in the middle, then we can move this vertex up as far as long as we stay inside the light cone. So these local problems are solvable if we are, let's say, low enough. So everything will be fine. If we move too far, then the local problems are not solvable anymore, so that's the only restriction we have. So how does this look like in, let's say, in a 1D, a bigger problem, but just 1D? Again, we have the C bar, and then we can proceed in time. So we always have a solution on the advancing front, which is drawn in green here. And then we can proceed, moving all nodes forward, until we reach the end and have our solution at the final time as desired. Okay, in 2D, nice movie. So we have the tents growing in parallel. What's nice about this is all tents in the same color can be solved in parallel. So it scales quite good if you have bigger meshes and you can use this to scale on shared memory machines by now. Okay, so tent pitching itself, as I said, it's high order in space and time, depending on the method you apply. So there are various ways to do this. It has a quite natural way to use spatial adaptivity. You have local varying time steps depending to, let's say, material parameters or in the mesh size. Instead of the global CFL, which we would have in a standard time stepping regime, we have a local causality constraint, which speeds up the code quite a bit. And as I said before, it's easy to parallelize using task-based parallelization. So we build dependency graphs, and then we just set the number of nodes we want, or the number of cores we want to use, and let it run. One point which is not that nice, the tent itself has no tensor product structure, so the time stepping is not that easy. So one option would be to use a space-time DG. There are some works on this as well, but it's quite memory consuming. So especially in 3+1 dimension, the problems get quite big. So that's one point we want to change and want to fix by introducing a mapping. So here I have some references, but most of them, they all did space-time DG. So what we added is the mapping. So we apply a Duffy-like transformation to map those tents to a tensor product domain. So we leave the spatial vertex patch untouched and map it to the cylinder, which is a tensor product of the space and the time interval from 0 to 1. So we have the tent is built from the bottom advancing front and the top advancing front, and the phi describes some manifolds somewhere in the tent, and it's a linear combination just between the old and the new advancing front. Okay, in 2D, looks similar, so we always solve on quite simple domains. Okay, so if we apply this mapping now, we end up having a slightly different equation. So that's a, let's say, the easiest model of a hyperbolic conservation law. You have some state vector U plus the divergence of a flux matrix, if you have more components, is equal to 0. And using some space-time divergence, you can write it in that way. And then we can apply the Paola transform to it, which then leads to a similar equation, which is now the space-time divergence in sense of the same spatial variable and the new pseudo-time t hat. Okay, if we do all the calculations, we end up having an equation like this. So we have the pseudo-time derivative of the of u hat minus f times the gradient of phi plus the divergence. And the u hat is the composition of u with the mapping. So one thing which shows up here is the delta, that's the tent hat, which is pretty nice in, if you think about DG. So all the boundary terms on the outside of the tents vanish because the tent hat is zero in this region. So we just have to consider the inner edges, so there's no communication outside of the tent. Okay, so easiest approach, you have an equation like this. You take a DG method and discretize on the local patch. So then you end up having an ODE, like I wrote it down here. So you have a, in our sense now, time-dependent mass matrix, the coefficient vector, and the operator, which depends on F. So depending on the structure of our problem we are solving, these two operators, MT and A, might be nonlinear, and therefore a bit more complicated to handle them. So the easiest approach now is to introduce a new variable and transform the equation. So we would get the Y prime is equal to A of the M inverse of applied to Y. So that's the setting we know. We could apply a Rogan-Kutta method to it and advance in time. So what we see, even for linear problems, I took quite a simple example, the wave equation, which we rewrite in sense of a conservation law, a system, where we have a simple exact solution, and we take a fourth order Rogan-Kutta, a pretty popular one, should perform quite good. And what we actually see is a first order convergence. So in the beginning, the method looks quite nice, but finally the rate drops to first order. If we go back to this slide, so one point which is the problem here is the inversion of this time-dependent mass matrix, because it's linear in time, and if we invert it, we have a rational function. So that if you do all the tailoring for the Rogan-Kutta method, you find out that doesn't help, that the terms cancel out. So we have to kind of handle this in a more appropriate way. Okay, so for linear problems, there's one method. We call it structure-aware Taylor, which kind of takes into account that we have two equations. So it's like a differential algebraic equation, we have a site constraint, and you can kind of tailor recursively and produce more terms of your Taylor expansion of both components, and then you get a method which is as exact as you like. So you can find it in the Ecosome proceedings, which should be published sometime or on archive. And if we apply this, then we have nice rates as expected. So for linear problems, a well-performing method, and we have high-order convergence. Okay, so we can also apply this, as I said, to three-dimensional problems. One, for example, is the Maxwell equations. You can write them again in the sense of hyperbolic conservation law. And here, as I said before, we can have more components, so it's quite a big problem. 6 components in three dimensions, and if you imagine meshing 4D elements now, solving for 6 components is quite expensive. And we applied our method using the structure-aware Taylor and copied one of the one problem of the references where they solved kind of resonator problem where you have an initial peak somewhere in the middle and let the wave evolve basically in 3 dimensions. And one point, what we see here in the mesh, so we have quite fine elements here in the corners due to the curvature. There we make small time steps to be stable. In the rest of the domain, we have the bigger time steps due to the tensor structure. And for this, for P2, our simulation took around 20 minutes, and for the reference paper, they had for the same type of problem around 7 hours, so quite a speed up. Okay, another example where we can see the advantages of this method is if you have a domain and we have some waveguides in red where we have a slower wave speed and therefore we can pitch different heights of tens. And especially one thing here, we have a gap, so we have very thin layer of elements. So if we have the standard CFL, we would have it globally and we would need small time steps in the whole domain. And we can run that using our algorithm. So we have a sine wave, which is kind of modulated. So it's just a wave pack running around and we see the coupling, the structure as we wanted. And it works quite good. So. Okay, as I said again, we have the smaller tent, so we see in the end we have some tents which are a bit behind, but globally we're doing way larger time steps, so the kind of some tents which are a bit behind doesn't slow down the performance at all. Okay, I can show that here. So we see so I cut off some of the tents. So we see that we have some small layers here in the region where we have small spatial meshes. Okay, so now we solved something for linear problems. Nonlinear, different story. So the tailoring doesn't work that good. So we have to use a different approach, where we just a quick point to the problem. So the T hat must be handled in an explicit way. So we can rewrite the problem. So before I had just one big M matrix with the time dependency in here, and then if you split it off, you can kind of develop a different time stepping, which is like the Runge Kutta methods, but with a kind of additional term in there. So just jump over it. So for the standard methods, you would need some integration formulas for all the integrals, and there's just one additional term coming in, the DIJs. So instead of the budgeter blow, which we know for the run and cutter methods, we kind of get some additional coefficients for our problems. And we can apply those methods to nonlinear problems. For the Burgers equation, a simple example with the smooth solution. And instead of the reduced order for the Runge-Kutta method, we can improve again to the high order. Okay, so we can do that for third order as well. And finally, I'm showing some bigger examples. So the Mach 3 wind tunnel, which is probably quite well known, where you need some finer mesh in the corner. Again, we have a layer of small tents in the corner and bigger tents in the rest of the domain. And finally, I want to show, make it big, a solution where the shock comes in from the left and is reflected and is intersecting and works fine using those methods. So that's basically it. There are some references, I said on archive, earlier paper, and my thesis where I explained the tent pitching in more detail. So thanks.